So in our last lesson, we noted that the cost of equity is one of the big disadvantages to bringing in equity owners or to fund a business with more equity. And we also noted on this chart, if you remember, on this little graph, we wrote down the fact that the cost of equity is considerably higher for privately held companies than publicly held companies. So in this lesson, we want to kind of drill down and explore that issue a little bit more so you can understand what's going on and how would we actually measure and calculate what is the actual cost of equity between a publicly traded company and a privately held company. So there are two differences here, and cost of equity is one of the principal disadvantages. And basically, the cost of equity is a function of what return do we have to provide to that equity owner for the fact that that equity owner is putting money into our business and taking on risk. So what return does this equity owner want for the risk that they are taking on? So if this business is highly risky and speculative, such as a startup company, if you're just starting a company from scratch and you have no sales, no customers, there's a considerably higher risk there, and that means the return that that equity owner would want would be very high. On the other hand, if you have a business that's well established and you have a lot of new orders for a new product that you just came out with, or you have a pending deal with a new customer or a new distribution channel that is really going to ramp up your business considerably, then there's less risk. There's a lot of upside. So that would be less risky to that equity owner, and the required rate of return would be lower. So that's what we have to measure and figure out. Now, if you are a publicly traded company, for publicly traded companies, companies traded on the New York Stock Exchange or over-the-counter markets in a market, and publicly traded company means they've issued common stock to the public and anyone can own that company. So in the case of publicly traded companies, such as General Motors or Microsoft or some company that's traded on an exchange where you can buy their common stock, then we can use something called the Capital Asset Pricing Model, or CAPM, Capital Asset Pricing Model, to calculate what the cost of equity is for a publicly traded company. And basically the way it works is the more volatile the common stock price of that company is, the more risk. So if the stock price of a company like a bank or a utility company is pretty well established, it's a very mature company, it doesn't fluctuate and move very much. It's pretty safe and stable. So it will have less volatility and less risk. On the other hand, a company that is in a very competitive marketplace, where there's new competition, low barriers of entry, could be very volatile and change a lot, and could be very speculative, such as a software company. So there'll be a lot more higher risk when there's volatility of the stock price. So risk for publicly traded companies is very much linked to the volatility of the stock price, to the volatility of the stock price. And we can take this model, capital asset pricing model formula, and we can plug in some variables to figure out what is the cost of equity. And we can start with something called the risk-free rate. So if I didn't take on any risk, what kind of return would I expect? So if I go out and buy something like a government security, the government is not going to go into default and go bankrupt. It's going to be around indefinitely. So the risk of default is virtually zero. So if I buy a government security, like a government bond or a treasury bill, that equates to a risk-free rate, a risk-free rate. How we measure the volatility of the stock price is a function of the beta coefficient, the company's beta, company beta coefficient is what measures this volatility in stock price. So if a company's stock moves exactly with the marketplace, such as the Standard & Poor's 500, so as the overall marketplace goes, our stock price, our company stock, continues to move exactly with the market. That would be a beta coefficient of 1.0. On the other hand, if our stock price moves more than the overall marketplace, so if the overall marketplace went up 10% and our stock price went up 10%, that would be a beta coefficient of 1. If our stock price goes up 20% and the stock market prices for overall companies goes up 10%, then we're more volatile. There's a wider range between the marketplace. So our beta coefficient will be greater than 1 point something. And if our stock price doesn't move that much in relation to the market, such as 0.5, then it would be very low risk. So the beta coefficient is basically measuring the volatility of the stock price in relation to the marketplace. And every publicly traded company, there are subscription services that publish these beta coefficients. There's more than one service, and they sometimes vary how they calculate that. There's a special algorithm that each service uses. But we can easily get to the risk-free rate. We can figure out what the company's beta coefficient is, the overall market rate of return. So if all of us out there invest in the marketplace in publicly traded companies, like the Standard & Poor's 500 goes up and goes down, we can figure out what the overall market rate of return is if we just invested in the Standard & Poor's 500. So we can take the risk-free rate plus the beta coefficient times the difference between the market rate and the risk-free rate. So if the risk-free rate happened to be 2.8%, let's say we invest in government securities or very low-risk securities, we get at least 2.8% return. The volatility of our stock price for our publicly traded company is 1.37, so it's a little bit more risky than the marketplace. Then what we can get in the overall market rate of return is 12.5%. 12.5% minus the risk-free rate, 1.37 is the beta coefficient. So if we work out and we calculate this and we plug it into this formula up here, we're going to get 16.09%, the cost of equity. For this publicly traded company is 16.09%. Capital asset pricing model used for publicly traded companies to figure out the cost of equity, okay? So now let's put the private company hat on. Let's switch gears because we said the private company cost of equity can be considerably higher because there's a lot more risk involved. So we can't use this capital asset pricing model to figure out private companies, so we have to kind of construct this. One way we can construct what the cost of equity is to kind of build it up. We can start with the risk-free rate, same thing that we started right here. Start with the risk-free rate. Risk-free rate, so we're going to add some risk premiums to that to build and build and build to get to what is the cost of equity for our private company. Different industries will have different risk premiums. The industries are sometimes a function of things like barriers to entry. If it's extremely easy to enter an industry, then your barriers are very low. You're going to have a lot of competition. On the other hand, if the barriers to entry are rather difficult, you'll have less competition. Each industry has its own competitive advantages, disadvantages, and variables that determine this risk premium. For example, software companies tend to have rather high risk premium because they have a lot of competition, there's a lot of innovation, versus banks, utility companies are a little bit more stable, but the barriers to entry to start up a utility company is extremely high, so you're not going to have much competition. So the risk premium, we'll add a risk premium related to our industry. You have to understand your industry very, very well to figure out what this risk premium is that varies between industries from software companies to banks to whatever. So we'll add in a risk premium because we happen to be in a high-risk industry. There are company risks. So our company may have specific risks. For example, we may have key personnel. And if those key personnel leave the company, we could lose a lot of business. Or maybe half of all of the business of the company resides with one contractor or one customer. And if that one contractor or customer goes away, half the business goes away. That's extremely high risk. So we have to see, we have to measure and figure out how risky is the company itself. Does it have a good management team? Does it have a good strategy? Does it have a diversified set of customers? Things like that. So we're going to look at, we'll start with the risk-free rate of return. We'll look at specific industries that we are in and add a risk premium because we may be in a very high-risk industry. Then we have company-specific risk, and then there's even a sizing premium that you can add because the reality is small companies have very high risk. The probability that a small company will go out of business 5 years from now is very high. But on the other hand, if the company has 100 employees or 500 employees and has $10 million in sales, then the risk premium goes down. So the smaller the company, then the higher the risk. So it's not a bad idea to add in a sizing premium. And as you get bigger and bigger and bigger as a private company, then you may not even need to add a sizing premium. But the small companies, you should probably factor in a sizing premium because the probability of growth and the probability of success long term is rather low. Okay, so we can use this build-up model to kind of help give us some idea what the cost of equity is for a private company. Another way to figure out what this cost of equity is to put yourself in the shoes of that other equity owner who's about to put money into your privately held company. Because when a private equity owner comes in and he puts money into that company, he is going to be very interested in what the value of your company is. What is your business worth? Every time you make an investment in any long-term investment, especially a company, if you're going to invest in a private company, everything has a benefit stream to it. So you expect to realize some benefits from that investment, a cash flow benefit stream. The most common benefit stream that is used to attach value to private companies is to go to the earnings, the income statement, and look at the earnings, E for earnings, earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization. EBITDA is the benefit stream that is very commonly used to assign value to privately held companies. Earnings, you add back, so you go to the income statement, you look at your earnings or your profits, you will add back the interest that you pay on loans, you will add back the taxes, the state and federal taxes that you pay. Interest and taxes are the most common non-operating expenses on the income statement. Depreciation, amortization, these are non-cash flow expenses. So when we add these back to the earnings, this kind of gets us to an operating cash flow number, the benefit stream that we will use to assign value to that private held company. And the reality is when you sell equity interest or you sell a privately held company, if it has like $10, $20 million in sales, then chances are it will sell for a multiple of this benefit stream, such as 3 times what your EBITDA number is. So when you bring in an equity owner who wants to put some money into your business, then you have to kind of understand what this is. This kind of helps you understand, how should I price this investment to this new equity owner? Because that's kind of going at a little bit different way. For example, let's just say, I'll write on here, let's just say we have $100,000 of EBITDA. So I took my earnings, I added back interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization off the income statement, and I have this number of $100,000. So now I want to go out and say, oh, I want to bring in a new equity owner, and I will sell him 20% of the business for $200,000. So you want to bring in a new equity owner, he will have 20% ownership in your company, and he will put $200,000 in. So what you have to do is you have to kind of think like he or she's gonna think, okay, he or she. So if you have $100,000 of EBITDA, and you divide this by 0.2, that's going to give you a value, and this is not writing as dark as I'd like, $500,000. So what he or she's going to do as this prospective equity owner, they're going to size up your business and figure out kind of, they're going to do a rough order idea of what they think your business is worth, okay? And they're going to say, well, you're only worth $500,000 and you want me to invest 20%. That comes up to $100,000 and you're asking for $200,000. You have overpriced. I am not going to give you $200,000 for 20%, dude. That's not going to happen. Because your EBITDA number, your benefit stream is only $100,000. I'm only coming up with a valuation of $500,000 for 100%. So I'm not going to pay you this. So as an equity owner, when you run a small business, you need to understand these numbers and how equity owners will think, so that when you bring in an equity owner, you can understand this relationship. So you can reconstruct your cost of equity by going through a lot of analysis, bring in some experts to help you figure that out. Sometimes you can also compare your company to a company that's in this, a publicly traded company that's in the same identical industry as you are, and then you can add in these to kind of get some ideas. So we can kind of build in and back into this, and at the same time, make sure you understand the benefit stream and how equity owners tend to think, so that you can kind of have a meeting of the minds as you bring in these new equity owners for your private company. So this is kind of how we measure it for publicly traded companies, and this is how we measure it for privately held companies for equity. And this is probably the last lesson in this part one of this course. By the way, we do in part two get into how we figure out benefit streams in the investment section of part two of this course. So we'll drill down in a little bit more detail into this in part two. So that pretty much concludes it. There's a course summary that comes up here in a minute, and I'm also going to talk about how you can get official credit and a certificate of completion for taking this course. So that's going to be in the very, very last section of this course.